We're going to have fun today. We started last week talking about humility, and this is a one slide for about 5 weeks or whatever it is. But we started talking about humility. I'm going to keep zeroing in on this. The Lord's just put it on my heart. Humility, as you can see from that slide up there, it just disappeared. It's so humble it hit itself. It doesn't like to be put up there. But you can find a lot more than this. But these are seven verses, seven characteristics. I stopped at seven. I'm like, this is too many. I don't want to do any more than this. Today we're going to talk about strength, Psalms 10:17. But I just went ahead and throw it up there. That's sort of where we're going, a roadmap. This thing is too noisy. Every time I move, it starts creaking. Y'all probably didn't notice it, but my OCD was like, we're not doing this. And so maybe it's an indication I need to lose weight. That's probably what it is. And so, but here's humility, and that's where we're going. Now, it is amazing when I started getting into this and looking into it more. I've had this sermon written for about 9 months, and it just felt time to release it. But ever since then, I'm like, this is a big deal to the Lord, this characteristics. The problem with it is our culture, as I said last week, some of this will be reviewed because we've got some different people in here. Our culture teaches us to self-promote, especially, and it just really took off when social media got in here. Social media, it's all about self-promotion, putting your stuff out there. It's become our culture. It's become the American culture. No matter how successful you are, say as a businessman or a teacher or whatever, you fill in the blank. If you're also not famous, you're not considered successful. Success has moved from just being having enough money, maybe even a millionaire, doing what you're supposed to be doing in life, to you have to have 10,000 followers or more and everybody knows about it. I'm just telling you, that is messed up. That is not a God thing. And as you look at scriptures, Jesus in his 3 years of ministry, especially at the beginning when he healed somebody, what did he often say? That's right. Don't tell anybody. It's not time. That was what I was supposed to do. But there's certain callings with being famous, and he didn't even want to go there. He was always discouraging it. But see, if that had been me that had healed that person, I would have had a nice selfie, photo op opportunity, promoted it everywhere, boosted the post on Facebook, and said the next meeting is tomorrow night at 7 p.m. in Capernaum. And he just had a whole different thing. His whole thing was, I am about pleasing my Father and doing the will of my Father. And he realized the danger of being famous. And that is, we stop doing the will of the Father for us and we shift it to doing the will of the people to get their approval. It's a very, very dangerous game. Now, there's nothing wrong with Facebook. I like seeing pictures of, I don't have any grandkids, but my brother Brian's got a bunch of grandkids. We're on their Facebook page, and they're always posting pictures of their grandkids. I love that kind of stuff. That's a good use of it. But if I'm not careful, I can get pulled over there at work, ministry, any other places. Why am I doing this? Or even more, many times the Lord will call you to do something that most people will not like, and then there's this battle. I might lose some followers here. I'm not talking just about social media. I'm talking about life, okay? I may tick off a family member. I may tick off something, make somebody not like me, not want to talk about me, but I know this is God. And so humility keeps you in the right path. It keeps you focused on the only person I need to please, and that's a very iffy term because we know we're pleased, you know, the Father's pleased with us, is Father God. But in the end, He's going to be the one when I stand before Him at the end of my life, and I, there, He's, He's going to come up. We're going to have to give an account for every word and deed. And my followers, whether they're you're here or they're on social media or my employees at work, will not be there. They're going to be back in the crowd trembling, going, I hope I can answer the question when my turn comes. And nobody's going to be there to support us. But I want to be able to stand there and go, Father, to the best of my knowledge, it was not perfect. I screwed up here and screwed up there. But the trajectory of my life was to do your will and to follow your commands. Because that's the final thing. And so, humility, we're going to talk about a little bit about what humility is. But humility is not a personality type. It's not the quiet type. Oh, he's quiet. He must be humble. He might just be shy and scared to death and have severe insecurity problems. Or he might not. You can't tell outwardly whether somebody's humble or not. Man, that dude sure is arrogant. Well, he might be. He might not. You know, as I heard years ago, there's a fine line between arrogance and confidence that you got from being in the Lord's presence. How many people would have said John the Baptist was arrogant? Sure looked like it. But my gosh, he spent enough time in the wilderness, it got burned out of him. And he was confident and bold. We're going to talk a little bit about this with his strength, because the Holy Spirit gave him an assignment, and he didn't care what the Pharisees said, the Sadducees said, what everybody else said. He came out of the gate because he knows, I am going to be judged on this assignment. He didn't realize in a year he was going to be dead. But he embraced and lived like he was going to be dead in a year. And so humility is not quietness. It's not weakness. It's not typically what we think of what it is. It's not even self-denial, although there is a place for self-denial. Humility, let me give you two definitions, or two things I wrote down. Humility is seeking God's view on my life and doing it. If you're quiet, you'll do it quietly. If you're loud like me, you'll do it loud like me. But that's a personality. It's not, we can't mix up personality with motivations. He's just, you know, we're talking about Sean in the prayer room, how he's a sanguine and outgoing. He said, I'm ready to go out there, maybe and dress like a clown and put a raccoon over my, swing a raccoon over my head to get everybody's attention. And I'm like, how do you even think of that stuff? It's just his personality. He didn't mean it seriously. Well, you could say, we know Sean, and it's not true. We could say, man, he's just an attention getter. He just wants to be the center of the party. That's just his personality. Okay, you could be very humble, swinging a raccoon over your head. I couldn't, he could. Humility is recognition that we have all been given gifts. We've all been given strengths. We've all been given pluses in our personality. But we realize to be successful in our gifts, callings, personality, regularly, daily, we have to submit it to the Lord and say, let me get better at this. Let me be fully who you created me to be. And then when we do something well, say, Father, thank you. That was fun. I enjoyed it. But I give you the credit because you set it up. You made it happen. You carried it through. And to continually give him that source back. You don't have to do it in public. Do it at night before you go to bed, because it's all a motivation thing. So let's talk a little bit about strength and confidence. That one in the lower left corner. I just picked it randomly because that's what I felt like talking about today. Is that honest or what? Psalms 10:17 says this. O Lord, you have heard the desires of the humble. Now, remember last week we talked about what's one of the steps to being humble. Let me just go back and just talk about that real quick. It's to humble yourself. We can humble ourselves? Yeah. Let me read a verse from last week. Luke 14:11. I'll come back to Psalms. For everyone who exalts himself shall be humbled, and he who humbles himself shall be exalted. We've already talked about that. You humble yourself. We know, as we talked about last week, pride goes before a fall. Don't wait till you fall. You don't have to wait till you fall to be humbled. You can humble yourself now. It will keep you from tripping up. Turn to the person on your left and say, I know that doesn't apply to you, but it does to me. And so you just, you can humble yourself. Humility is doing like what I talked about earlier. So let's go back and talk about strength. Psalms 10:17. O Lord, you have heard the desire of the humble. That's you. Amen. Say, that's me. I'm humble. Thank you for my gifts. Thank you that I have an awesome personality. Thank you that you gave it to me and I didn't do anything for it. But thank you that you're going to help me be the best that I possibly can. You will strengthen their heart. Okay, strengthen here. You will incline your ear to listen to me. That's good. Humility brings God's listening to you. And humility brings strength to you. I do this all the time at work. I'm a software programmer. Even though I've been doing it a long time, there's always new stuff that come along, and I go, I have no idea how to do this. And so after trying for a little while, and I don't know how to do it, I'll step away, walk around a little bit, and go, Father, thank you that you have given me this job. It's a great job. I love this job. Keep the job going. Help me to be the best I possibly can, and I need an answer to this thing. And I'm just going to walk around and think about something else for a little while. But when I get back, thank you, you're going to show me a new direction, new way, and eventually we're going to get this thing solved. It always works. Sometimes it's 10 minutes, sometimes it's a day, sometimes it's a week. But I just keep humbling myself, say, Father, you know how to fix this thing. And He strengthens your heart. How many of you have been depressed, discouraged, you're facing a hard situation, you're facing a tough time, you got a relative, employee who won't work well, and it just tends to bring down your emotions, right? Am I the only one in here, or are you guys always up? Humble yourself and say, Father, I don't know what to do. You know what one sign of humility is? It's going, I don't know. Great three words. Or as tech speak is, three initials, IDK. First time I saw that, I was like, what the heck are they saying? They must have misspelled something. I've now learned, as a side little point, whatever I get on, I used to reply back, go, what does IDK mean? I still do that sometimes with other things. But I've just learned to Google, go to Google and go slang and then put the initials in. Because I'm an old person. But there's always new stuff. And sometimes they don't mean nothing and they did misspell. But anyway, so it's just say, I don't know. Matter of fact, you sent me a couple weeks ago a question. You sent me a question. It doesn't matter that they're like, and I basically replied back, I don't know. Here's a website that seems to have some good answers on it, but I have no idea. You remember that? Just don't make up stuff. If you don't know, just say, I don't know. And, now, humility brings strength. It brings promotion. We're sort of going to blend these things together. But if you're a typical American, you don't believe being humble and not promoting yourself brings promotion. It doesn't make sense. I've got to promote myself. I've just got to. I've got to do it. All of culture tells you to promote yourself. Jesus is the perfect example. He never promoted himself. And then at the end of his life, at his death, God the Father promoted him because he refused to promote himself. How would Craig's life look different if I never promoted myself? I mean, that's a tough question. Just be faithful, love justice, walk humbly. Do we trust God enough to promote us? I struggle with that a lot. Maybe you do, maybe you don't. And so, do we trust God if we are truly living for Him and He's happy with us, is that enough? Walking in humility does a number on your motivations. Years ago, I was praying, Father, we want more people here, fill it up, do this. And the Lord just said, why? Well, it sounds spiritual. We want to help more people. We want to do more things. And He started doing an inward search. I'm not sure. There was some of that. But some of it, I just want to be around more people. It's cooler. It looks like you're more successful when you got more people. He didn't answer it, but when God asks you a question, that means you're saying the wrong thing. And he's trying to redirect you somewhere else. And I started this journey that to this day, I don't pray that prayer anymore. Because it says in script, now I'm sort of going off on a side point, but I'm trying to give you an example of asking why we do what we do. It's a hard issue. You can't judge anything on the outside. It's all a motivation issue. I don't know why you're doing what you're doing, unless you tell me. Because the way it looks on the outside of why you're doing it, if I did that same thing, that might be my motivation. You know, we always put our motivations on other people. If that was us, this is what we'd think, so we think they're doing it. No, we don't know, unless they tell us or they give some indication. But God's pushing us in to go, live for me, leave the results to me. I will line up the circumstances however you want to line up the circumstances. He took me on a journey of talking about, there's a scripture that talks about water, plant, water, and grow. That's the cycle of every Christian. We get planted a new truth in our life. We put some water on it with biblical truth, and then it grows. And he asked me, he says, is there anywhere in the New Testament where man ever caused anything to grow? Now, I might have missed it. We're to plant, sow the seed, hear the word. We're to water it, which means take care of it, don't rebuke it, don't get rid of it. Because in that same passage, he says, I cause it to grow. And he showed me, he said, there are many churches growing. Some of them are me. Some of them are man's motivational techniques that are no different than trying to get people to go to Walt Disney World. We can't tell the church doing that or not. It's a motivational thing. That's between them and God. You can make things happen, but believe me, at 60 years old, you do not want to make things happen if God's not in it. Because then you have to keep it going all the time. If something happens and God gives it to you, if he takes it away, it's cool. If he wants to keep it going, cool. I don't really care. I'm going to keep my eyes on him and try to be good stewards of whatever he gives me. We got 30 people in here. I'll try to be stewards as a pastor of 30 people. If there's 300, I'll try to be a good steward of 300. But I'm no better. I've not been promoted. I'm not a better teacher. We don't have a better worship band if we have 300 or 30. You be the best wherever you're at. Let me read to you. I like to read business biographies, so I'm going to summarize this. This was a book by Jim Collins. Jim Collins wrote the one of the best-selling business books out there called Going From Good to Great. It's a good book. I've learned things from it. He wrote a book before that called Built to Last. I'm going to paraphrase from it. He's a faculty member at Stanford University graduate. Anyway, his goal, this was in the 1990s, was to research 15 companies that had lasted, I'm sorry, a list of companies that had done well for more than 15 years. And he said, I want to try to find the universal characteristics distinguished by truly great companies. He came up with a set of benchmarks. You can buy the book, go read it. And they identified 11 elite companies. Some of these were Kimberly-Clark in the paper industry, Abbott Labs in the pharmaceutical, Nucor Steel, which is obvious. And he said, I want to find out what makes them great, but I do not want anything to do with the CEO. That's important, or the leader. Okay, we're not studying the leaders. There's plenty of books on leadership. What makes a good CEO? But I want to know the culture, the climate. After much time with his research team came back and said, it's impossible to separate the CEO out of it. He said, no, I don't care about the CEO. I want to know. The data ended up winning. And they realized all of these great companies were led by what he calls a level 5 leader from 1 to 5. Listen to what he said. This is a secular guy. He said, all of the 11 great companies that we found, they were led by a level 5 leader. A level 5 leader, they were all this way. They were a study in duality, duo, two characteristics that went together. Quote, level 5 leaders are a study in duality. They are modest and willful. They are humble and fearless. They were humble enough to know what direction to go and then pursue it, as he said, with a combination of, quote, personal humility and professional will. They were all humble that lasted. Isn't that fascinating? As you look at the Tim Keller, who's a Presbyterian pastor in New York, I wrote this quote down. The humble are kind and gentle, but contrary to what most people think, are also brave and fearless. If you are to be humble, you cannot have one without the other. Humility produces a strength that humility is not following the crowd. Humility is digging deep. In this case, listening to the Lord and also knowing yourself and going, what does the Lord want me to do? And out of the strength of the relationship as a Christian, you know, I don't know where non-Christians get their strength from, but out of the strength of that, it's probably knowing the right answer or the right direction. Out of that comes a strength that you cannot get by following a crowd. Let me just remind you of some of the great leaders in the Bible. Moses, as we said last week, Numbers 12:3. This is God talking about Moses. Now, Moses was a very humble man, more humble than anyone else on the face of the earth. And that's amazing. I don't know how many people were on the earth when Moses was around, 50 million, 100 million, I don't know. He was the most humble man on the face of the earth. God had to pull Moses out of the backside of a desert, tending sheep, to be the deliverer of Egypt. You see this pattern all through the Bible. And this is what I know I struggle with, maybe you struggle with. If I'm just humble, don't promote myself, how am I going to advance? How am I going to get noticed? Does anybody else struggle with that? What? You may not. You have to drop that. There's two kinds of ambition in the Bible, ambition and selfish ambition. Have ambition for Him, and then He will always take care of you. In more ways than you realize. Moses, when you think of Moses, you think of this awesome guy and a hero. He left at age 40 in disgrace and shame because he killed a man in Pharaoh's empire. He's a wanted man. And he goes and hides out with a bunch of sheep. God speaks to him. I want you to be a deliverer. He even has a burning bush. How many of you have had a burning bush experience? The bush catches on fire because the guy just wouldn't pay attention. And he speaks to him. And he still has to talk him into it. But man, did he end up being bold, have strength, and fearless in the end. Listen, you follow God and His voice and you will not miss it. You'll get more promotions than you ever thought, but it'll be promotions He wants you to have that feed His ambition instead of your ambition. I remember I was 23 years old. And I wanted to start a church, be a senior pastor, be a leader, do all that jazz, da, 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 da. And that was God's plan for my life. But man, what it was going to be at 23 is a whole lot different than it ended up being. I didn't believe in charismatic theology. I didn't speak in tongues. It was going to be in Atlanta or some other major city. It's just totally different. So at 23, I didn't have any choice. I take a job as an engineer at Plant Vogtle Nuclear Plant in Waynesboro, Georgia. I went. Why? Because my parents wouldn't support me anymore. And I had to go get a job, and I couldn't find another one. As I'm leaving Atlanta, going on I-20 East to Augusta, Georgia by myself for the final time. I mean, I went over there a few times interviewing, finding an apartment, all that jazz. The Lord says, you're going into your wilderness. Wow. What a message of victory and hope. What an encouraging message. It was none of these nice prophecies. You're going to the land of prosperity and a city that I will show you. No, you're going into your wilderness. How many of you want to get a message like that? I needed it, and it was a wilderness. Little did I know it's going to be 10 years of wilderness. Some people are just slower to learn than others, and I was one of those. But in those 10 years, I helped be an associate pastor at three different churches. Well, why three different churches? Because some of them closed down and left me, okay? It wasn't that I was rebellious or whatever. And so that whole time, I mean, I did all the grunt work you can imagine. No glory, no whatever. But I knew God was in it. I said, all right, I'm just going to do what you want me to do. This is my wilderness. I don't want to jump out of it and go around the mountain for 40 years. If I had tried to promote myself any time in there, it would have been a bigger mess and worse trouble. It might have been fun for a little while, but it would have been a mess to clean up. And God's like, dude, I'm trying to get this guy to Dalton, and he keeps jumping out. All right, whatever church he started on his own, we're just going to have to get him there. And there were opportunities. I mean, there was one time I was 28. I came here at 33. There was one time I was 28, 29 years old, and a group of 100 people came to me and asked me to be their pastor. That's more than what's in this room. It was tempting. Wouldn't have been 100 before it got over with because God wasn't in it, or else I would have had to do a lot of self-promotion. And so you have to, you look for doors, you look for opportunities. He opens doors, he opens opportunities, but make sure, Lord, are we doing this thing together? Let's walk in this thing together. I don't want this to be my thing. I want this to be your thing that I'm helping you with that becomes my thing. John the Baptist. Wow. John the Baptist. Think about this. This is a great example. There was a time in scriptures where his disciples were complaining that all the people were leaving him and now following Jesus that John the Baptist just baptized. This was his answer. Jesus must increase and I must decrease. He's living for a different purpose, and he's highly exalted today. Jesus later said he's the greatest prophet ever born of woman. Well, what does that mean? That means every prophet. There's no prophet that wasn't born of a woman. Except maybe Adam, but I don't think he's a prophet. Apostle Paul, towards the end of his life, he openly shared his struggles, and he said, I am the chief of all sinners. I'm not that humble yet, but I'm working on it. He wrote 2/3 of the New Testament and started almost every church mentioned in the book of Acts. We already talked about Moses. And so it's just amazing. Strength is found in the humble life. Promotion that lasts into eternity, and promotion where you don't have to sell your soul for, and promotion where you don't have to manipulate is from the Lord if you let Him promote you. But this is what I'm going to tell you practically. It is always longer than you thought it was. And when it finally happens, you really don't care anymore. And that's sort of the goal. I had no idea I was going to be in Augusta. I can tell you other stories, but I had no idea that I'd be in Augusta, Georgia for 10 years. And when it came, I was excited, sort of. But I knew I was on the path of it, but not like it would have been at 23. And that's good, because there would have been too much mixture of myself in it. And so what the Lord does is He prepares us for His tasks in the right time. The problem is we don't quite know what the tasks are yet. But we think we do. We can see it. And maybe it'll happen that way. Maybe it won't happen that way. But we don't care. As long as I wake up every morning and go, Father, am I pleasing You? Am I doing what did I do yesterday? What You wanted me to do. Am I doing today? Let me today do what You want me to do. I'm telling you, you will not miss the will of God doing that. Even if you veer off because we heard that, you will not miss the will of God. All right, I'm going to do one of these each week. Well, I want people to like me. I don't want to be like John the Baptist and have to eat locusts and wear crazy clothes. I wrote down 9 ways to be unlikable. I'm only going to do 1 or 2 today. Next week we'll just do at the end. Because there are things, that doesn't mean we're out to try to make people not like us. That's not it. That's not what I'm trying to do. Be likable. Be enjoyable. Be your personality. You will draw, Jesus drew people around him all the time. He just wasn't controlled by people, and he didn't get his self-importance from people. All right, so here's the first 2 I want to throw out. 9 ways to be unlikable. So we want to do the opposite of this, and then we'll close out. Do not humble brag. Do y'all not know that term? If you're not, you're Googling it right now. This is, we see it on social media all the time. I'm trying to think of an example. Let me make up an example. Say one of my kids do something awesome, win some award. So I post it out on Facebook, and that's legit. You want to tell the world. You know, Abigail did this great thing. And you post out there a picture on it. Humble brag is going, I guess all those years that I prayed and interceded for her when she was not following God paid off. Okay, it went from bragging to humble bragging because somehow or another the attention is now on you. You follow the difference? Social media is full of this stuff. It's a humble brag. If you're going to brag, brag about the person. You know, don't brag. Don't throw yourself at the end. Because what happens? Everybody sees that and they go, okay, I'm glad for Abigail, but that's really disgusting. That is a cheap trick throwing that thing in there. Everybody sees it but you. Amen? So don't humble brag. Oh, here's another one. Emotional hijacking. See, these 9 ways to be unlikable is really 9 ways to not bring attention, is not to talk about yourself. Let me give you an example. Have you ever, a lot of movies, they come in, they got the boss, he could be a bad guy, he could be a good guy, and the employee or the assassin or whoever comes in and tells them it doesn't go well, what often happens? They bang their fists on the desk, they throw all the paper off the desk, or take their glass, throw it up against the wall, and they get mad and start hollering. Y'all know what I'm talking about? That's emotional hijacking. It's now become about you instead of the problem, and you're throwing an adult temper tantrum, and you're trying to get somebody to fix it, and it's all about you instead of fixing the problem. And so, don't do that. Don't make it about you. Say, man, that's disappointing. What can we do? I've done marriage counseling. It's never happened in my own marriage. The silent treatment. Have you ever heard of the silent treatment? I know none of you have here because you have perfect spouses. Something happens, you do something, and you get the silent treatment. That's emotional hijacking. It's now become about you. Now, I'm not saying you don't have feelings. I'm not saying you don't have to work through stuff. But when that happens, everybody, what does everybody do? Run away. Get away from them. I've seen this at jobs I've had. I've never had a boss go that far, throw stuff and knock stuff off their desk. But I've been back there with the employees, and you're taking bets, doing, you know, rock, paper, scissors. Who's got to go tell the boss something happened? Because it's not going to go well. And whoever goes always gets punished, even if it's not their job. Don't be one of those people. Be mature. Say, well, that's disappointing. I need to think about that for a little while. And go and get your emotions under control. So no humble brag, no emotional hijacking. Let God promote you. Do not promote yourself. I don't think you can go too far the other way. Amen? Hopefully this has been humbling and also practical. Just stand. Father, I'm just going to pray a blessing over you. If anybody wants me to pray with you, I'll be up here in the front for a little while. and upstate of mind. There you go. New York church, New York t-shirt. Father, I just thank you for these people. I love these guys. And I just pray you give them a great week this week in intimacy with you, in maturing in you, and that it'll just be a great adventure of following the Holy Spirit this week. Just bless them, protect them physically, protect them, their souls from barbs and damage, and just protect their spirits in Jesus' name. Amen.